Menschen gepusht aus King Sahayaka in the mid-15th century. Pisa does not mean the chronicle Shaw does not actually appear until the mid of the 15th century with the chronicle of King Sahayaka and Alpantina. With this communication, I would like to try to understand why in the middle of the 15th century the chronicles emerge, trying to show that this is not due to an external influence linked to his translations of new texts, but to internal processes in the Ethiopian community. My goal today is also to grasp how history was produced within the kingdom before the emergence of this new genre, and what this type of history reveals about the uses of the past. The different forms of recording the past and of literary compositions about the past are all related to the monastic milieu before the mid-15th century. It is therefore a very peculiar kind of history that is written. Christian marking a universal mission in which Christian time is punctuated by the birth of Christ or the great councils. These are seen as crucial moments in history around which the division of time is articulated. This is particularly clear in what is commonly called the royal list. This list occupied in manuscripts combining historical traditions, compositional books, Ethiopian chronicles, universal histories, hagiographies, and some regulatory texts related to royalty. August Dillmann and Carlo Contiocosini isolated them and grouped them by types according to the dynastic list they could give, sometimes distinguishing contradictory lists contained in the same manuscript. Here, I would be less historical content of this list than in the conception of time, the way history is written in the Christian kingdom of Ethiopia. As an example, we can compare three lists and the reference to time in these three lists preserved in two manuscripts, Ethiopian 64 from the National Library of Travis and Ethiopian Dabati 105 in the National Library. Ethiopian 64 is a 16th century manuscript in which there are commentaries on the Bible and treaties on the Kabbalah concept. In this manuscript, we can distinguish two ways to come time and to place Ethiopia in a universal history. In the first short treatise, the history of Ethiopia is linked to the history of the world from the Greek Council. Then the historical Ethiopian times are marked by dynastic successions, kings of Aksum, kings Sago kings, and then the king Sinsiukunuanak, with a specific interest about the cycles, in fact, the 532-year cycle to which Professor Stephen Hamer just talked about a few minutes ago. The writing of this legal treatise is therefore to be placed in the 14th and 15th centuries because there is this allusion to King Sinsiukunuanak. And we can see here the influence of the computers on the redaction, on the writing of these treaties. A second little treatise appears in the same manuscript at the end of the manuscript, and this one gives a list of Ethiopian kings, named kings of Aksum, which begins with Awe, the snake king, and mentions the names of kings until the reign of Bazen, considered as a contemporary of Christ in the Ethiopian tradition, and then stops at the hour without specifying why, but probably because these two sovereigns were then considered as the first Christian kings. The name of the council is mentioned in the list, but without giving rise to particular historical reference. And the list goes on with the Zagreb dynasty, who took power from the line of David and the people of Israel, refers to the restoration of the kingdom by Yekunuanak, and then draws up a list of kings up to the end of the kingdom. And here we have, in fact, another treatise dealing with mystical history and Christianity in the kingdom of Ethiopia. Also, these two treatises intersect at one point, especially from the Yekunuanak time. Their way of looking at the history of the kingdom is opposed. In the first case, Ethiopia is considered in a universal history. In the second case, attention is given to history more properly in Ethiopian. The two are not reconcilable, and the treaties are simply juxtaposed. On another list, Tabati 105, we can read passages quite similar to what we are just seeing in the second chronological treaties of the manuscript Ethiopian 64, concerning the Zagreb and the Kuban. On the other hand, the beginnings of Ethiopian royalty are located in another context. There is no reference to Agwe, the snake king, but to Solomon, Makeda, and their son, Emma king. This list is preserved in a manuscript which is dated from the reign of King Bandamaria in the 15th century. Consequently, the royal list and chronological treaties form in a very different forms. Typology of Contemporini as age forms seem to be much more than least updated reign after reign. It is more likely very elaborate historical constructions. Although abbreviated, they require a cultural and literary background that is implied and perhaps explained orally when this is itself as a medium for teaching. They seem to play the role of elementary structure of a story developed orally, but this is a result of historical constructions. Far from constituting the beginnings of a history written in the monasteries, these lists are in fact the last link in a historical chain, whose first production must be sought elsewhere. Two examples can serve us to better understand what is happening in the monasteries in the centers of production of the writings of the Ethiopian kingdom in the 14th and 15th century. Recently, the works of Alessandro Baozzi and Antonella Brita have shown that the translation of the Martyr of Arepas, counting the events taking place in Najd in the 6th century, when the king of Ethiopia, Caleb, went to South Arabia to fight against the Jewish king for the Christians, that this Martyr of Arepas was translated from Arabic to Persian in the 13th century as Terminus Antiquum. And this Martyr of Arepas is the source of the life of an Ethiopian monk, Saint Pantaleon, presently written during the 14th century. I do not intend to speak about the events themselves today, but to be interested in the reasons why, in the 14th century, presumably in the monastic period, a legendary life is composed by taking inspiration from translated texts and transposing them. The main idea to note is that in this Ethiopian hagiography, The Life of Pantaleon, the story of the king and of the Ethiopian kingdom is subject to the theory of the state. It is Pantaleon who is essential for the victory of Caleb. The king is going to seek support from him before going to battle, and it is the saint who miraculously appears to the Axumite army in decisive battles. This is hagiographic topos, which is also regularly repeated in Ethiopian hagiographies. But this way of writing history then inspires also hagiographers, such as those of the monastery of the Polymanos at the beginning of the 16th century, when they were writing the life of another saint, Paracelsus, their abbot. This composition is also a sacred history of the kingdom associated with the monastery from the Polymanos. The hagiographer of the Polymanos had knowledge of the life of Pantaleon, using it to compare Paracelsus to Pantaleon. The abbot of the Polymanos is thus depicted as the new protector of the kingdom in the 15th century, while King Baudamaria goes to war, just as Pantaleon was the protector of the kingdom in the 6th century. Moreover, it has been also demonstrated how the Gaja Pantaleon, the Martyr of Arepas, were used in the composition of the last chapters of a very important text in the historiography of the Ethiopian kingdom, the Kakanes. Similarly, with regard to the ascension of the Zagreb dynasty, or therefore, the monks, through the hagiographies, write the history of this period, mixing knowledge and probably historical research and reference to a mythical history whose development plays a considerable role in the Ethiopian kingdom. The side passage from the book entitled Gilgamesh, generally translated as Glory of Kings, but may also be rendered by Dignity of the Kings, the historical myth telling the story of the meeting of King Solomon and the Queen of Sheba, the birth of their son Hadad-Ashi, and the transmission from Israel to Ethiopia of the legitimate royalty of divine right symbolized by the transition of the Ark of Covenant. The Covenant ends with the colophon denouncing Zagwe as a non-Israelite family. All the problems posed by this text, and in particular the first one, the question of the dating of the text, are not solved. But it seems that from the 14th century, the Capernaum was known and spread in the Ethiopian kingdom. Hence, the influence of this text in historiography and the place of the Zagwe dynasty in this historiography. In some copies, the Cabranagus ends with a genealogy which begins with the Ethiopian ruler contemporary of Jesus Christ, Azen, continues with an enumeration of kings up to a certain Ben-Nahab, and then the genealogy ends in the following way, as the list already pointed out in manuscript Ethiopian 64 and Ethiopian Levati 105. I don't quote this on the slide. Archaeographies written during the 14th and 15th centuries are inspired by this mythical framework to justify either the taking of power of the Zagwe dynasty or the restoration of a dynasty belonging to the line of Israel. Together, all the ideas. The role of monasteries is evident to the extent that the lives of saints are written in monastic communities. Most of the time, it is the monastery in which the saint is good. Takes care of the writing of his life insofar as the text in question is an indispensable element to the commemoration of the saint. During the 14th and 15th centuries, in the active state of our knowledge, lives of saints often include, if not always, a reference to the history of the kingdom, not just the local history related to the monastery's own life, but the story of kings and dynasties. The monks thus make the choice to have past. And this one, as one saw for the list, is at the same time encapsulated in a Christian conception of time, inspired of biblical history extended, and embedded in a mythological construction, just such as that found in Kilgamesh. Here too, the monasteries have a role to play. The handwritten list of books kept in the libraries of the monasteries show that they are the depositories of texts translated from Greek or Arabic into Greek, like the Martyr of Aretas, also Protocopanagus, and then use these texts to write their own archaeographies, Gerlapantaleon, or to develop and change the text, like Protocopanagus itself. It is still rather difficult to define in which direction the information circulated between Gerlapantaleon and archaeographies in the monasteries. Before Alessandro Rossi, it seems that the final chapters of the Capernaum, as transmitted in the Ethiopian tradition, are the outcome of a relatively late tradition, bracing the Acts of Aretas, the Capernaum, with related archaeological texts and the Capernaum itself. Therefore, the Capernaum is not a text given for once and never modified later. It is, in fact, adjusted regularly according to the historiological constructions that prevail in the kingdom, like for the last chapter in relation to Ismachan and the list of kings, for example, at the end of the colophon. And that is why taking this text, identifying in its milieu or source, poses many problems. An exceptional turning occurs during the reign of King Sahayagor in the 15th century. For the first time, the documentation reveals a writing of history that is not only due to the monks and the monasteries. On the side of the right of foot, one takes hold of the past as a resource to make the panegyric of King Sahayagor. And this term is made at the instigation of King Sahayagor himself. Surprisingly, however, Sahayagor does not introduce the writing of royal chronicles as a new genre. He plays in some way on the same ground than the monks. His goal is to conception of history and power to the Ethiopian people, his conception of Ethiopia too. And to do this, he writes or supervises the writing of homilies, miracles, which are meant to be read in churches. He also ensures the dissemination of texts in churches. His system has been particularly effective since there are manuscripts preserving the text of his homilies in almost all the monasteries and Ethiopian churches. Here are some examples of this text. In this text, the king uses reference to past crimes to construct a frame of understanding of the new king. For example, in this quotation of the Book of Life, which is a homily of King Tamayako, there is allusion to events which occurred during the reign of his brother King Tesak in the beginning of the 15th century. And we can find also allusion to this specific reign in the homilies of Tamayako. He also draws the ideal portrait of the king, partition versions of history, which are sometimes built on simple cycles. I will not develop the examples here, but Tamayako deals in his homilies with the way in which he came to power, conspiracies that were conducted against him by dignitaries of the kingdom and members of his own family, the heresy of a number of clergymen, many of whom were rather in opposition to the king and who have been accused of heresy for being eliminated. In this text, the king's prowess is exalted too. For example, his victory during the battle of Gomit against Adad Sultan Balai, modeled on the history of the wars of Amad Sinan, with the project of highlighting the bravery and strength of the king, supported by God without the intermediary of any saint. We are therefore in a universe that is a priori very close to the history taught in the monasteries by the monks through hagiographies or chronological treaties, between an extension of the biblical history and the election of the kingdom by God through its means. What is more, a large part of this text is probably written by clergymen or by those who write in the monasteries another history. But, and this is a very big difference, this history is controlled by the king. In hagiographies, the engine of the history is not the sovereign. When the king of Ethiopia appears, he is always presented as paying homage to the holy man, whoever he is and whatever the context. Tsahayako reversed the historiographic perspective by constructing a history of his own reign on the model of the history of the present time, placing the king as a representative of God on earth and as a driving force of the history, as an instrument of self-presentation. The past and the history are used as a resource for the present. This royal control over the writing of history, as it appeared at the time of King Tsahayako, gave rise to the birth of a real good historiography, the writing of the first royal chronicles devoted to Tsahayako and his son Baudomania. These chronicles are written by those who wrote the homilies and miracles, playing both political and religious role in the kingdom and the court. These chronicles, as already shown by myself, exist in two versions that are not complementary but contradictory. The first version was written by a witness of the two kings. He had an intimate knowledge of the achievements of the kings. Cross-checking the first chronicle with all the pragmatic documentation established during the reign of Tsahayako indicates how much his chronicler was informed and how rich his history of the reign is. There is therefore an intimate acquaintance on the part of the chronicler of court life of the royal family, whom he can use to write his history. Unlike the self-history produced by Tsahayako, the first version of the chronicle is very critical of the reign, even though the author acknowledged great reforms to the ruler. He begins his history in very harsh terms, problem of the text I quoted on the slide. In a sense, the chronicler delivers a critical vision of royalty, distinguishing what makes a good king and what makes a bad king. And this is probably the reason why the second version was established, second version of the Chronicle of Sarajevo and Babylonia. It serves to correct the excesses of the first version and allows precisely to move towards the birth of a new genre, a royal historiography. From then on, two forms of history are written in the kingdom. One in the monasteries, which gives rise to the abridged chronicles or short chronicles, which emerged in the 18th century, and the other to the good, the royal chronicles. To conclude very quickly, it seems that there were tensions in the Christian kingdom between two forms of history, hagiographic history written at court and monasteries like the homilies and the miracles written under the supervision of Sarajevo, or the history of saints in one side, and in the other side, historians serving primarily Christianity against the service to the king. One last thing for me is very important to note is that it's still very difficult to understand why in the monasteries in the 14th and 15th century there was this very important decision to write history inside the hagiographies. And I think we will not be able to understand this since we are not able to know exactly what was the context in the Christian kingdom of Ethiopia in the 14th century, because we don't have chronicles for this very long.
Confiscated by the official, let's call it the official history as such, for the past 60 or 70 years, in which it says the Berbers came from, originally from Yemen via Horn of Africa and Mosul, and then arrived in North Africa, which immediately translates them into Arab, as you see. But this is ideology. So we have in Morocco this business of the negationist or historical denial, I think is what you call it. There's a lot of that around. And in addition to that, sorting fact from myth and finding the exact historical event is always a bit of a problem. So I will talk about this notion of the distant past, Zman Akhim. I will also talk about prophecies which were very popular in Morocco between the 16th and 20th centuries about various events which were going to happen, but which were often a throwback to the days of the heretical Arqawada prince. I will show you a map in a moment to explain this a little better. Then we'll talk about some field work I did in the Middle Ages, trying again to establish historical truth in the face of myth, especially with regard to fortifications. Then the greatest, well, the most important chapter, possibly, or subchapter, is the medieval history and the role of the outsiders on the Atlantic seaboard, that is, the Burgues, in Portuguese, and the impact that had upon the local psyche and perception of history and resistance to these invaders, together with the sprouting of all these Sufi orders, these religious brotherhoods, I have something to say about them, and then this fact that the Arabic language gained a lot of predominance in the harem of the most Atlantic plain and elsewhere, and as the language retreated into the hills, as it were, and was based on the Zawiyahs, which perpetuated and as their scholarship as seats of learning, and which there was not only orality, but also written text. We'll have a word to say about that. Then we'll come to the last century, 20th century resistance to the French invasion. And here again, I'll talk about what I call the Aztec factor. I'll tell you what the Aztec factor is. But it's the notion of something which is such a devastating disaster. It's the word Tulen, which you see up there. That's the inevitable calamity which has to happen sooner or later, and there's nothing you can do about it. Rather like the Aztecs against Cortes back in the 17th century. Then we'll talk about armed resistance and the basic topic of this in the present political psyche and perception of recent time, especially focalizing on the Tuzi's elder and a lot of field work. And finally, recent history, as it has appeared, committed to paper, with the first appearances of the novel, Ungel, the element of rather an inaccurate backward projection, I put it, towards specific happenings. So they will talk about the year of the famine, you see, as a present boy in Europe, for example. They will talk about colonization in French, they will talk about independence in 1956, and they will just say, yeah, many, which is terrible, of course, but even Rome was also. Or else, when King Hassan II unleashed the hordes on the Western Sahara, then a Spanish colony, that is also that happened in 1965. They will say that they were put in the Green March, so the density sold in Amazon. A few quick maps of Morocco. A lot of what I've mentioned is what happens here on the Atlantic coast. You see the Nutella. In central Morocco, as of the 16th century, there were these prophecies which circulated, prophesying that one day their disaster would befall Morocco. Disaster, two men, you see. And there was this guy called Manhoj. Also a whole lineage. went on citing his alleged prophecies well into the 20th century, even when there was no proof that they actually emanated from his CDA or his savings, which means that there was an element of humbug around all this. But that's the way some of these Igurans and these saints exercised their control over their parishioners. So one of the most famous was this: "Will come a day when Britain shall spawn a black donkey, a shaggy, whose teeth shall devastate the world." Well, of course, this is to do with the battle of Bath during the Mahavata period, and also the idea of the Antichrist, the Dujjal, arriving on a black donkey. It's a mixture of all kinds of things. Now, here is again the unspoken history of Morocco. This is, well, Horifrid. It's not far, it's 30 miles from Rabat. And on this site, there is the tomb of a guy called Ibn Yasin. All of you have all known him. He's one of the Almoravids, and he spread the Almoravid or Moravid faith throughout Morocco. He was killed here, but the history of Morocco doesn't tell you how he was killed. But I'll tell you, he was killed fighting against these heretical Barbatos. But there's such a sum of ignorance in the country that it takes historians or other scholars to know about it. And I learned this from a great friend of mine, Mustafa Al-Qadiri, well known. So you see, Ibn Yasin, you can hear all about him in the history books, conquering Ibn Yasin, but nobody said that he was defeated in battle by the Bonaparte, and if you would see this two on the top of his head, it's unknown in Morocco. Then we come to the Portuguese, the Portuguese. This little fortification, is typical 11th or 12th century Almoravid or Almohad architectures. It exists in the Middle Ages, and I've done a lot of research on this place. It's called Latin Mehdi. It's supposed to have been some local saint who called himself Mehdi. And actually, he was put down by the Almoravids when they arrived at Conquer. This place, and the whole place was sacked and burnt. And this bit of fortification still exists. If you look there now and ask the people about this fortification, do you know what they say? Oh, that's not Almoravidism, that's Portuguese. You see, again, conveniently, the Portuguese who didn't come onto the scene until the 16th century are supposed to have created this. Whereas it's typical Almoravid or Almohad fortress architecture. Some people in the village will tell you, oh yes, that fort, that dates back to the lifespan of 9 grandfathers ago. So what that was, the lifespan of 9 grandfathers ago. How more inaccurate can it be? Okay, I'll let you think about that. Now, here is the Histoire de l'Histoire. That first bit of fortification I showed you is one of those presumed sites of this Calatrava in the Middle Ages. But this is the rival site, Fresco Pogara de Rifa. And I also went to check it out. It's far more elaborate. My hunch, this is not only a hunch, it's based on what other researchers, including Arsène Bourdelle, it's probably an Almoravid fortress which was built later. Later 11th, early 12th century, 18th. We move on. This is a typical Atlas village. This is just to personify the next dynasty after the Almoravidun, where the Almohadun were built. The thing is that wherever you go in the Atlas Mountains, and there's a bit of ruined fortress or an old bridge, people live there and say, Portuguese. Again, this is because the strength of orality among populations who do not master the written word, and so this idea of the Portuguese having reached right into the Atlas Mountains, which historically speaking is almost nonsense. Well, that's why this has started. However, I have the honor to help Professor Mohammed Kerry translate his latest official but opened up Moroccan history, running to 700 pages. I helped translate it into English and French and Arabic, into English with three Moroccan colleagues. And I'm happy to say that in there, they do allow all the fact, as I say here, that the Portuguese went as far as the outskirts of Marrakesh. I think I have to move on to the next picture, which is here. Here you can see where the Portuguese had their enclaves, around Aspi and around Santa Cruz de Agadir. They would go inland, you see, or like that. And it has been historically proven that they reached the outskirts. There is historical proof of this, and the official history accredits this. However, you will find legends to the effect that they reached as far as Amina, you see, right up in central Morocco, where I did most of my field work. So, again, sorted out between myth and history, you have to do quite a job. Here's another view from Morocco, a more detailed one, which to include because of the importance of this place called Dinar. It was the seat of Amazigh scholarship, which also became the seat of a would-be Amazigh dynasty in the year 1630 after the Sayyid dynasty. He tried to affirm himself that he managed to do so over what's showing up Tamsanat and Kharu, as far as the Atlantic coast. He even got as far as exchanging ambassadors with England. Okay. But they had two serious dynastic rivals, the Shur, the Ishmael, who were moving up this way, and the eventual winners, the Filala Shurafa. Filala was based on Tafilet, who eventually they came from Yenbor in Arabia, and who are, of course, the present reigning Alawi dynasty. So there was this dynastic contest about this time, and that's when Dila finally lost out, not so much to the Tazawwad Igurema, but to the Filala Shurafa, and that the Zawiya Dila was sacked, but there's still a few ruins left, but all its scholars were taken to. That was the end of Amazigh scholarship in the Middle Ages, or Fezzes, as it used to be called in those days. Again, these various names, Fezzes. If you speak to a Moroccan verb about Moyen Atlas, if it's not Francophone, we won't understand. But if you say Fezzes, okay, we understand. Now, these various places where the Amazigh retreated, they had these monasteries, these zawiyas, and these became seats of learning. And the Amazigh language survived. You see, this is Zawiyat Sidi Hamza. This was an offshoot of the Zawiyat Dila, which managed to survive. It wasn't sacked. When the Zawiyat Dila was sacked in 1666, this place, Zawiyat Sidi Hamza, survived and functioned right up to the present time. And here's another view of it, as you see, the typical mountain location. And they had quite a few of these They had quite a few of these texts. This one is very pedestrian, it's about ablutions, but it's written in Arabic calligraphy, as you
And you see, the
Arabic the ability to write Amazigh in Arabic was maintained by this guy in the Talmud. Here's the book of Amazigh Talmud, or Fiqh as they call it in there he is writing on a cedar plank. Has also